The Pleiadian Mission, A Time of Awareness. Part 10 continued to Part 11. That is the level of his understanding at the time, and he will make simple laws for his society. As we progress and grow in experience, which leads to intelligence and higher consciousness, we will make different laws that reflect our understanding of creation that are more in line with the complexity and level of knowledge of our society. We are continually evolving and changing as a society, therefore, we must be open to creating new laws and paradigms that will keep pushing us forward instead of holding us back. We must become aware that all living things are part of the same creation. There is an interconnection that binds us all together, something like a network of consciousness that I refer to as spiritual bonding. As we think, our thoughts run across the network and affect all other life forms that are connected to it. Thought is energy, and energy contains thought. They are the same thing existing in different form. Spiritual growth is the forming of logical thinking that is harmonious with the laws of creation. When you have perceived something correctly, with great clarity of thought, and understood it to the point that it has become part of your life, dictating your actions, the wisdom learned from the experience contributes to your spiritual growth. In order to control your spiritual growth, you must learn to take 100% responsibility for your own actions, thoughts, and deeds. You cannot dump your responsibilities on any other life forms, gods, idols, or cults and expect to grow. No other life form, including gods, can grow for you. When you have learned to face your problems with your own energies given to you through creation and know that you are part of creation, you can draw on the spiritual force that is within you and achieve all that you can imagine. It is unfortunate that we are born into a material world unaware of the great spiritual knowledge we are connected to. When the Earth human learns of the great power and knowledge that is within the spiritual subconscious, he will begin to help others in the world with the right kind of teaching and guidance so that they can live life to its fullest and most rewarding potential. The path to spiritual growth is through the recognition of our role within creation. The equality of man. It has been said that all men are created equal, and we are. We all start as spirit forms of equal knowledge, or I should say, lack of knowledge, for in our beginning state of pure energy we know very little. It is creation that gets us started on our path of growth. Once we come into our first lifetime, the learning process starts. We begin to accumulate wisdom from our experiences, and we create a path of learning that will continue for billions of years as we go through the stages of development of human life. All along this path we are learning different things at different times. It is the accumulated wisdom that contributes to our intellect and our aptitudes, causing us all to be unique individuals on our own paths of learning. We all need different knowledge at different times because we are on separate paths of learning. As we go through life, we slowly learn all of the lessons of life, but not at the same time. Eventually all of the lessons are learned by everyone, so never can we say that one person is better than another, we're just at different levels of learning. It is the wise man who recognizes that he is only older, not better, and uses his older self to help the younger through love and understanding. The man who uses his older self to take advantage of a younger spirit form, or get ahead at another's expense, is living in spiritual stagnation and still has some hard lessons to learn. Peace will come to Earth when everyone realizes that we are all spiritual beings of creation on our own paths of development, and we make space for other spirit forms so that they can be who they need to be and learn what they need to learn for themselves, without any judgment or harassment from us. It is the truly enlightened one who recognizes the spirit in his fellow man and sees him not as a material being, but as a spirit form on his own path of discovery and learning. Spiritual growth. In front of Billy's house there is a patio for guests who visit the center. There is a guest book to sign and 5 large photo albums you can look through and see the most beautiful and clear pictures ever taken of Pleiadian or any other spacecraft. The signatures in the guest book are from countries all over the world, attesting to the great interest people everywhere have about our connection to the family of man throughout the universe. I had my laptop computer with me and was busy entering in some details on what I had learned the past few days when a man came walking up the road to the house. He turned out to be from Kansas, where I was born, and had heard about Billy and his experiences, like many others, so he came for a visit. We had even attended the same college and both had majored in psychology. He had gone on to become a professional psychologist and started a practice, while I had never used my education professionally and had ventured off into private business. I had him sign the guest book and offered him some time alone with the 5 photo books while I tried to find someone around the farm for him to talk to. During the day it was pretty quiet around the center because most of the FIGU members worked in town at regular jobs. Billy was in the kitchen, but as usual, he wouldn't come out to talk. It had been years since he had greeted visitors or answered letters. He had become a real recluse as far as the world was concerned. Freddie and Silvano were out working in the fields, and Poppy, Billy's wife, was in town on errands, so our visitor had to settle for me. He could only stay for a couple of hours, so I had to do the best I could to answer his questions. Since he was a psychologist by profession, he was concerned with the development of man and how we think and learn. His questions were among the very things I had been studying lately, so it gave me a chance to explain it as best I could. I had just been typing information into my computer to get things clear in my own head, and now I had a chance to try to explain things to a learned man who had studied the science of humanity. We spent most of the afternoon talking and having a great time examining the Pleiadian concepts with principles currently used on Earth by his profession. It was an interesting time of discovery for both of us and actually helped me to learn through explanation. I had explained the concept of creation and how the universe had developed, but most of his interest was about the actual process of spiritual growth. It seemed so different from what was currently being taught in our school system. Since we had both gone to the same college, I was well aware of what he was talking about. The process of spiritual growth as explained by the Pleiadians was quite different from what he and I had learned in school. The process of spiritual growth. One of the ways that a new creation contributes to its evolution is through the mechanism of spirit forms, human beings who create material lives to learn from. During that learning process, wisdom is obtained through experience and adds to the spiritual growth of the individual and the evolution of creation. Wisdom is knowledge that creates energy. The more we learn, the higher level of energy we provide to ourselves and the creation. The process of spiritual growth at the material level is accomplished through the gathering of information with the material senses, which is processed by different levels of consciousness, and eventually is stored in the spirit as part of the accumulated wisdom of the everlasting spirit. This process of spiritual growth is a natural one that goes on whether we are aware of it or not. The advantage of understanding the process is that we can be in control of the rate of our growth, the quality of information we expose ourselves to, and develop methods by which we can live a happier life and be in control of our minds. We can also learn to understand the purpose of our lives and better understand the path of evolution that we are on. You have only to look around you at the millions of people who are unhappy, depressed, angry, or out of control, and you can see the immediate need for a better understanding of how our spirit works with our material self. Before we examine the actual process of how we add wisdom to our spirit and create evolution, let's have a look at the levels of consciousness that will be performing the internal work. Once we know how our spiritual self works with our material being, we will see that it is very similar to how creation works with a spirit form. Creation evolves by creating a material universe through which it can learn. The universe, a material manifestation of the wisdom of creation, goes through cycles of waking and sleeping during which it creates life forms of many types that learn from experience. The human spirit form works the same way and follows the pattern set by creation and the universe of which it is part of. It creates a material body, which goes through cycles of being awake and being asleep, while it learns from experience. How the mind works. Did you know that modern science cannot yet detect the origin of thought? We can trace down what part of the material brain the thought is in once it causes a synaptic junction to charge. But the origin of thought, that place in our mind where the idea comes from, cannot be seen or touched, for it isn't material. The mind is energy, both material and spiritual, and sends information to the material brain to be processed to the cells. Let's take a look at the general layout of how the spiritual mind and the material mind work together. For the sake of our discussion, I have drawn a diagram which will help explain how the two minds work together. On the right side, the spiritual self is represented, and on the left is the material self. There is no relationship to any part of the physical brain, for this chart represents the mind, the area of consciousness where ideas are carried out through the action of thoughts. Let's start on the left side of the diagram, the material side. Before we come into life, we are only a spirit form, but once we are born, we create a material body with a brain and develop a material consciousness. In order for our body to be able to perceive information, we develop the five senses with which we are all familiar: hearing, touch, smell, sight, and taste. You will notice on the diagram that these are all attached to the material conscious mind. This is how we gather the information which starts the learning process. You are exercising your sight right now by reading this book. The conscious mind, then, is our connection to the outside world. It is how we make decisions, all of our thinking processes, everything that we consider, contemplate, and speculate on is done here. This is where all of our actual thinking is done. Next is the subconscious or unconscious, as it is sometimes called. This represents the area of consciousness where we store all of the thoughts that occur in the conscious mind. All of our feelings, perceptions, all that we see, experience, hear, or anything else that penetrates the subconscious is stored here. This is the computer control center of the mind. It is responsible for guidance, control, and all of the internal communication between the different areas of the mind. Between the conscious mind and the subconscious, there exists a sensor, or filter, that all information passes through. Everything that passes from the material conscious to the subconscious passes through this control center. All superficial thoughts, including anything that was seen or heard superficially, will be blocked and not passed onto the subconscious to be stored or considered. Our senses see and hear millions of pieces of information that are around us all the time and are of no particular interest to us. This unusable superficial information is what is blocked out. For instance, if you are sitting at a busy public restaurant with many people hurrying about, eating, reading, waiting on tables, cooking, and engaging in thousands of pieces of information that your eyes and ears may perceive, all this is simply superficial information that you have no need or interest in, so it is blocked out and not stored. We have an internal sensor called a we form by the Pleiadians. It is the source of what is called primary telepathy that operates through the ears, a kind of hearing that allows one individual to send thoughts and sounds to another. It is short range and cannot be used off of the planet. It is most effective in close quarters to sense what someone else is feeling or thinking. When the phone rings and you think you know who it is, you are using the we form of primary telepathy. That fact that it can sense information from many different sources, something like a network or an inner telephone, brought to mind the term we form. The person receiving telepathic messages can learn to create a block so that others can't pick up their thoughts. The psyche is a storehouse of feelings which make up our disposition or morale. Your emotional feelings and attitudes about the world around you are in here. Here is where you will find feelings of sympathy, melancholy, cynicism, joy, spite, euphoria, optimism, pessimism, depression, anxiety, and fear. From here you may find the feelings of isolation from the world or changing the world for the better. The feelings in the psyche help form the view that others have of us. Since the material consciousness, subconsciousness, and psyche are created by the spirit form, the same levels of consciousness exist on the spiritual side as well. The exception is the psyche, for its counterpart on the spiritual side is called the Gemüt. This is a German word which means sensor. The Gemüt has no feelings like the psyche, but it is able to think and is the connection we have to outside consciousness, for it is our connection to creation and to levels of higher thinking. Some think of this as the silver thread to the life force, or God. The spiritual consciousness works much the same and acts as a receiver and sender of information to the spiritual subconscious. It works like an observer and gets a copy of all that the material senses pick up. The spiritual subconscious is a wonderful accumulation of all of the wisdom learned from the many material lives lived so far. It has the ability to draw upon this resource of information and send hunches to the material side when we are trying to make decisions. This hunch is usually the first little thought that creeps into our minds when we are trying to make a decision. Once man becomes aware that he is more than just physical, he is opened up to his real spiritual existence. There is also a we form on the spiritual side which is used for telepathy, but it works in a slightly different way. Since information through the spiritual we form is using spiritual force to send and receive, it can transcend the normal distance problem and communicate with others anywhere in the universe. It has almost no barriers of time or distance and is very difficult to block. If one were to receive information from a human on a distant star, that is where it would come from. The message could be sent from many light years away, and it would be so fast that you would think the sender was right next to you. Thought is actually much faster than light and is almost immeasurable in speed. Since it is spiritual in nature, I believe the great speed is due to thoughts being networked through the energy of creation itself, which is everywhere. This is what would account for the fact that thoughts can be transmitted almost instantly anywhere in the universe. Now that we have some idea of different areas of consciousness and memory and what they do, let's follow a simple thought from its inception and see how the mind works with it. For the sake of this example, let's take something that is familiar to all of us, food. Let's go back to our busy restaurant and pick up the menu and follow our thoughts as we try to make a selection. Our eyes have just fallen on the luncheon special, which is beef stew. In a split second we read the letters that say, luncheon special, beef stew $3.98. That probably took our eyes a second to read. During the space of that 1 second, our material conscious consulted with our subconscious millions of times about what it was reading. As the visual image of luncheon special, beef stew $3.98 came into view, our conscious mind created a visual image of the letters and sent it off to the subconscious. It was quickly considered by the filter to determine whether the thought was superficial or not, and then passed on to the subconscious. The incoming thought, remember, is energy, and as such, it is oscillating at a particular vibration. Each time we think, connecting impulses are immediately created which determine the vibration of the energy and the charge that carries it. As soon as the subconscious received the image, it quickly checks in its memory to see what kind of data we have on luncheon special, beef stew $3.98. If the vibrations of our subconscious memories connected to this image are in conformity with the vibrations of the conscious mind, the response is sent back to the conscious mind, via the filter once again, that we have similar compatible vibrations, and the conscious mind quickly produces a feeling of sympathy. If the new vibrations sent from the conscious mind cannot make a connection in the subconscious that is agreeable, but instead is of a degenerated or repelling nature, then the corresponding impulses will be sent from the subconscious back to the conscious via the filter that will cause the thoughts of non-sympathy or antipathy. The thought of sympathy or antipathy will rise to greater or lesser extent, according to the power of the vibrations in question. It should be understood that the conscious mind is not capable of creating a thought on its own. It cannot form it, develop it further, or execute it if corresponding impulses from the subconscious do not stimulate the activity. Although the entire information gathering is done by the conscious mind, it does not know what to do with the new information if no corresponding impulses from the subconscious realm are received. Because of this, the conscious mind and the subconscious flash back and forth very quickly in order to develop the thought. The first reaction may be a familiarity since you have eaten this before and liked it, so that memory is in your subconscious and will send sympathetic impulses back to the conscious. As soon as the subconscious sends back the first impulse, a thought begins to build in the conscious mind. It will continue to flash back and forth at incredible speeds as new information comes in, and the thought builds. The conscious mind begins to build a thought and continues to add new information from the eyes, ears, nose, hands, and mouth. Perhaps your nose picks up the smell of the stew that is added to the information and your subconscious will send impulses about the smell, letting you know if it likes it or not. Your eyes may see an order of stew on the next table, and that visual image is added, did it look good or not? Perhaps the person you're with mentions they got sick on the stew last week, and that figures into the thought you are building. Within just a second or two, a million pieces of data can be flashed back and forth to build the thought. Just as you are starting to form a thought about whether or not you should order the stew, you find out that the cook who made the stew is someone you really dislike. Now you have an immediate negative reaction and send very negative vibrational impulses to the subconscious which will, in turn, respond quite negatively. The thought of this person quickly triggers deep-seated emotions of hostility and anger in your psyche, and adds that to the flashes of bad memory in your subconscious, and then sends all of that back to your conscious mind. Within a split second, your entire mood changes, and you have no interest in the stew or the restaurant, and you want to leave. One's negative thoughts can be very disruptive to a situation. Now you are leaving a restaurant where you have been enjoying the food for weeks, just because it is cooked by someone you don't like. As you bolt for the door, your anger causes you to bump into the waiter and knock over his tray and, without excusing yourself, you race out the door. Your mind has just been through billions of flashes, mood swings, emotions, and thoughts. Within the space of a few seconds, your whole atmosphere has changed, all because of a negative thought that you created. Your conscious mind and your subconscious process new data and create thoughts like this continually all during your waking state. The memory of these events is stored in your subconscious and serves to influence the emotions and feelings in your psyche. As you sleep at night, your conscious mind is quiet while your subconscious is still active, sorting out the events of the day and coming to terms with them. If you had remained upset the rest of the day and had gone to bed in that state of mind, you would have gotten very little sleep because our subconscious would have kept dealing with your out-of-balance state until exhaustion finally set in, causing sleep. Even then you would not have slept well, for your subconscious would have been trying to solve things, and it would have been sending impulses back to your conscious mind, causing it to think and keeping you from a deep sleep. Our spiritual side never sleeps and is paying attention to what we are doing at all times. Each time a thought flashes back and forth between our conscious and subconscious, the spiritual side is listening to see if we are learning anything. So far, the events of the day have not been added to our spiritual subconscious, where the accumulated wisdom is cored. Spiritual growth is adding wisdom learned from experience to our spiritual subconscious, which will be carried forward through lifetimes. In order to do this, it is necessary that we learn from our experiences and make that new knowledge part of us. Once we have full cognition of knowledge and integrate it into our life causing change, then our spirit will add it to our spiritual growth if our new wisdom is correct, according to creation. Let's see how that works in this instance. You had a sleepless night of worry over how you acted the previous day and decided to go back to the restaurant to apologize to the waiter. As you are expressing how sorry you are for your actions and trying to explain how it won't happen again, the cook walks in the front door. Seizing the opportunity to cleanse yourself even further, you have a long talk with the cook, during which you find out you have been mad at him because of misinformation. There really hasn't been any reason to dislike him, it had all been a misunderstanding, so after some discussion you finish the conversation as friends. Walking away, you feel a great relief as the negative energy dissipates, and you have learned something about anger and how to deal with it. You even admitted you were wrong and faced up to the fact that your anger was uncalled for, and in the process, you discovered a new friend. You feel pretty good about yourself and even sit down and have the luncheon special, beef stew, $3.98. This new experience is also recorded in your material subconscious. You have made some progress in the emotional department as well, causing the psychic illness of anger to subside just a little. As the following days come and go and other situations arise that normally would have caused you to fly off in anger, you now deal with them with a new attitude. You have learned how to control your anger and have made a difference in your life that will stay with you. The wisdom from this new experience will be recorded in your spiritual subconscious. This is wisdom from experience that is added to your accumulated knowledge, and it will move forward from lifetime to lifetime. The lesson may have to be repeated several times to really heal your psyche, but now you're on the right track. Psychic illness is a buildup of emotions which are so negative that we can't live our life normally. Jealousy is about the worst condition to fall into. The many events that lead up to a person becoming completely jealous make this state of emotional imbalance very difficult to recover from. Psychic illness is caused by the illogical thinking of the conscious mind, which slowly creates the emotions through a buildup of negative thinking. When we are born, our psyche is clean and healthy. No one is born full of anger, depression, anxiety, or jealousy. These are all man-made emotions that are created from not being able to handle life's experiences in a healthy manner. If a person can learn to think in a neutral manner, instead of negative or positive, then he will not create the harmful emotions which rule our psychic feelings. Neutral thinking is the ability to clearly see things as they are without attaching negative or positive judgments to the thought. If we had just seen the beef stew as nothing more than just food in a bowl and had not attached any other emotions or feelings to it, we could have had a peaceful lunch with no problems. It was the process of attaching a negative thought to it that caused the difficulty. It is not healthy to attach overly positive thoughts to things either, for they can cause just as much damage in overinflated egos or attitudes. In the new age, we will all learn more about how to see the world around us in a neutral way, and live without psychic illness. It is very difficult in our current world to grow up without creating many negative emotions due to all of the trauma we go through as children. Many adults would agree that most of their emotional problems stem, in part, from a difficult childhood that created emotions which still play a part in their behavior. We are born into a society that does not understand us spiritually. There is no understanding of how we left the last life and what problems we may have starting this one. No one is concerned that we are spirits on a path of learning and need something special. Our society teaches that children are possessions to be disciplined and corrected. More than 50% of the young children in America today are victims of some kind of child abuse, most of it physical. Currently, more than one-third of all children are born into single-parent families, and they will be denied the natural order of learning that comes from two parents. We are creating an entire generation of young adults who will not benefit from the necessary role modeling from that missing mom or dad. We can only guess what effect that may have on our society. For those children who are lucky enough to have understanding parents who make an effort to try to comprehend the unique qualities of each child, they will grow up with far fewer problems. When we are young and impressionable, our psyches are forming, and our subconscious is just building its vast memory bank that we will draw from throughout our lives. If we can go through our childhoods being loved and understood and are taught how to think correctly, life will be one great festival of joy and happiness instead of a burden of emotional trauma. If, however, we wind up as adults who cannot control our thinking, life will be a burden of emotional pain. We would then find ourselves riding a roller coaster of negative and positive thoughts, causing our moods to constantly change. Having no control over our thinking, we would have a different opinion on things every day, making decisions almost impossible. Even though most of the world is caught up in this mode of illogical thinking, there is hope, because it can be reversed. Psychic illness can be corrected through the slow process of re-establishing logical thinking. The conscious mind can then start to build new thoughts which will, in turn, create new experiences from more neutral thinking. These new experiences will re-educate our emotions, and our psyche will slowly repair itself. Re-educating a psyche is slow work and can be very demanding. It takes the help of another person who is a more logical and clear thinker, for the stricken person is not capable of helping himself in the beginning. You cannot repair a thinking problem with the same illogical thoughts that created the problem. The food our spirit lives on is truth according to creation. Healing a person of psychic illness means healing through the powers of the spirit. Individuals must activate their own spirit to heal themselves. This means the power of their spirit must be motivated and become useful. The process of healing requires long explanations of pure logic which will motivate people to think correctly and use their own spirit. In effect, people wishing to heal themselves of psychic illness must be prepared to do a lot of thinking, because the people helping them cannot take over the mental work of others. It is only possible to give them a start in the right direction, but the ailing people must heal themselves. It is the mind that must learn to think correctly so that it will form new understandings and feelings. It is not possible to simply erase old memories and feelings so that everything will go away. The old memories and experiences must be replaced with new ones. The ailing person must first learn to understand exactly what the problem is, and then be led into new thinking through the aid of visual images so that they may have new experiences to replace the old ones. In the case of psychiatry, words of logic and self-discovery are relied on too much. The subconscious reacts better to images and visions, not word. Only the conscious mind can use words, and they can be misunderstood or misinterpreted by the ailing person. It is words from which we create visions and images. If we are sick, We will hear words and create images and visions that are negative or illogical, so progress is slow. Many people take the guidance of a psychiatrist for months and years and make little or no progress, since the treatment seldom goes past the stage of words on a couch. On the other hand, if you take an ailing individual out of his environment, away from all of the normal surroundings that he is used to, and give him a new environment with unfamiliar surroundings, he will have to immediately create all new responses to deal with this new situation. Then, if he is guided correctly with neutral thinking as he creates these new thoughts, experiences, and feelings, he will become a new person in a very short time. Old memories and emotions will be replaced quickly. If a person is spiritually weak and suffering and you are strong in spirit and healthy in mind, you can try letting them use your strength while they get theirs back. This can be done by the laying on of hands around the body in the region of the stricken person's aura. The aura is the field of energy around each person's body that reflects the condition of the spiritual energy. As you think, your thoughts create energy that shows in the aura around your body. If a person is sick, it will show in their aura. If you are strong, you can let your aura mix with theirs. Hold your hands around them in their auric field for several minutes, perhaps hours, and they will benefit from it. The power of your healthy spirit can help theirs get started. Sometimes just the feeling of your healthy energy is enough to make them feel better about themselves, and pull them out of depression or despair. You must be cautious to not absorb negative energies from them. This can happen if you are doing this because of ego or vanity, rather than love and genuine concern for another. If you try to help someone in order to show off or prove that you are very spiritual, you will do them no good and only hurt yourself. If, on the other hand, you are giving from your heart and expect nothing in return and think with a clear and logical mind, you can be of great help to another. When you are acting with your ego, you are spiritually weak and cannot protect yourself adequately. However, a spiritually balanced person is strong and will suffer no ill effects. This is the end of part 11. For more information about the Pleiadian mission, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Again, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Also subscribe and share this video. Let the whole world know the truth. Thank you for listening. Remember that knowledge is power. Please, don't be left in the dark. Please continue to part 12 in the next video.